Let's add in a couple more photos into our photos table, and we'll take a look at some different interesting queries we can write to explore the association between photos and users. So to add in a couple more photos, I'm going to write out an insert into photos. I'll then list out the different columns that we are going to provide. So we're going to give a URL and a user ID for each one. We'll then list out some different values. So remember, each of these sets of parentheses that we're going to write represents a different row that we want to put into our photos table. So for the first one, I'm going to put in another little fake URL right here. I'll put in http://2.jpg. And then I'm going to associate this second photo with the user that has ID 1. I'll put in a comma at the very end. And then I'm going to copy paste this line down a couple of times. I'll then fix the indentation. I'm going to update the URLs for each of these to something that just looks a little bit unique. I'll put in maybe a 25, a 36, blah. Yep, that looks good. And then I'll change the user ID in a couple of places. So we'll say that maybe user with ID 1 has 3 photos. Then I'll give the user with ID 2 1 photo. I'll give the user with ID 3 1 photo as well. And the user with ID 4 can have 2 photos. I'll then make sure that I put a semicolon on that very last line. Okay, so let's run this to add in a couple more photos. And then after I do that, I'm going to once again retrieve all the different photos inside the photos table. So we'll do a select star from photos. So now we can see the list of all the different photos that are inside of our database. Each of these different photos is associated with a different user. Some users have multiple photos, such as user with ID 1. It looks like they have 3 photos tied to them. User with ID 4 has 2 photos, and 2 and 3 have 1 photo each. So now that we've got a lot of data inside of here, let's figure out how to write some different queries to somehow retrieve these photos in a meaningful way. Let's take a look at a diagram and understand what that really means. So at some point in time in our application, we might want to retrieve all the different photos that are created by a very specific user. This makes a lot of sense. Think back to that profile page in the Instagram application we were looking at just a little bit ago. We were looking at a profile page for the user Instagram, and on that profile page, we listed out all the photos that person had posted. So this query right here is something that we are very likely to want to write out at some point in time in our app. We might want to get all the photos created by a very particular user. So let's try to find all the photos that were created by user with ID 4 by writing out the query you see right there. Notice how there's nothing really special inside of here beyond some of the syntax we learned earlier on inside the course. It's just a select statement with a from and a where to filter out some of the rows we get back. Okay, let's try that out. We'll do a select star from photos, and we'll say where the user underscore ID is equal to 4. And before I run that, I still have the results down here that are the list of all of our different photos. And remember, user with ID 4 has 2 photos associated with them. So when we run this query, I would expect to get back 2 rows, and both of them should have a user ID of 4. Okay, so I'm going to run that. And sure enough, there we go. We've got 2 separate rows. These are 2 photos that are both associated with that user. So now we could take this data right here, maybe send it to some kind of front-end application, and list all these different photos on the screen, and these would all be photos that are associated with this particular user. Okay, so let's take a look very quickly at one other query. And this other query that I want to look at is very complicated. I'm going to tell you right now. As an instructor, I'm not really supposed to tell you when stuff is challenging, but I just want to be really brutally honest with you. Understanding join statements in SQL is one of the most challenging, if not the most challenging thing in the world of SQL. So this is just going to be a very small little taste of a join statement. We don't really need to understand exactly what's going on for right now. Right now, I just want to take a very brief glance at it. I just want to run the query and take a look at some of the results we get back. All right, so we're going to write out back over here, select star from photos. We'll say join users on users.id equal to photos.jpg. user underscore ID. And then maybe instead of the select star right there, let's instead only print out URL and username. And I want you to take very quick notice here. These two columns I've listed out are columns that exist on two different tables. URL is a column that exists on the photos table. Username exists on the users table. So presumably, this join statement right here is somehow combining together the definition of two different tables. So we'll talk more about what join means in just a moment, but for right now, let's just run the query. So I'll run that, and now we can see a total list of all the different photos and the username with each associated user. So this kind of query right here would be fantastic if we were trying to build out some kind of main feed page, maybe some page inside of our application where we're going to list out many different photos and show some details about the user that had created each one. You might recall that the Instagram application, we even looked at a screen that looked vaguely like that, some screen that had apparently a photo on it with the user who had posted it. So this kind of query right here would be fantastic for getting a lot of photos and some details about the associated user. All right, so that's just a little bit on join statements. Again, kind of complicated, so for right now, I just want to give you a very quick taste of it, and we'll come back to this idea of join statements in a little bit. Okay, so these are two queries that we're going to write out fairly often whenever we are working with associated data. Before we continue with join statements, however, I do want to have a quick discussion about what these foreign key columns are really doing for us in Postgres. We're going to go back to that term that I mentioned just a little bit ago, that idea of data consistency. So quick pause, and we'll cover that in just a moment.